Mr. and Mrs. Werewolf by Whitley Strieber, copyright 2018 by Walker & Collier, Incorporated, may not be reproduced without permission. Everything was competitive. Even where your desk was located in relation to Nick's desk was competitive. Nick liked holidays, Halloween, Thanksgiving, Christmas. So, holidays were competitive. Christmas, you gave Teslas and Maseratis or you were a jerk. Thanksgiving was turkey, sure, but stuffed with caviar and chased by Chateau Latour. Halloween was costume time, and that was always a challenge. Nick was capable of spending 50 grand on his. If you couldn't do at least as much, you were marked as a failure, and if you weren't making enough money to throw it away, you were on your way out. You did wild things, wildly expensive, gutsy things. Jane and Robert Harper, who were the biggest producers on the floor, also did the wildest things. They hunted endangered species. They collected stolen art. And through one of their shell companies, they were making a fortune a month in the thriving Middle Eastern slave trade. Endangered species collectors were a subculture of the extremely rich and powerful and bitter. Here in New York, there were Rob and Jane, plus Henry and Tilda Lyson, who had collected gorillas. 2 years ago, the Lysons had disappeared under circumstances that still hadn't been completely understood. Animal rights activists were suspected. Joe Ford in San Francisco had amassed a magnificent collection of endangered snakes, and he disappeared also. In fact, on a buying junket, he'd landed in Borneo. That much was known. Then nothing. But the other collectors were just fine, and both Ford and the Lysons had been into all manner of ugly business, so who knew? It was now October, and the office was wild. The markets were headed up, and Roper Magnus was pushing Enviromedical into the stratosphere. In boom times like this, if you didn't ring the million-dollar bell at least twice a week, it was time to cut your own throat. Jane and Rob were company stars. Between them, they hit the big red button on the desk about every 24 hours. When the bell rang, it meant that you'd sucked a client to the bone and were ready for more leads. If you didn't keep sucking the clients, keep the money moving, Nick would foretell your future. Just die. Jane and Robert were running hard, but lately Jane was running harder. Rob hadn't scored a big placement in days. He was torching the phone, promising the personal intervention of God to the marks, while Jane was kicking back, pushing the button so frequently that brokers across the office were having the dry heaves. She was just plain rolling. Nick had her name at the top of the swinging dicks chart, way up there where the eight-figure players lived. That was bad enough, but what was worse, as far as Rob was concerned, was that she had some kind of a line on a major costume for the upcoming party. There were 4 days left, and right now he was coming in a Lone Ranger mask and a sharkskin suit. Last year, he'd been rolling, pulling cash out of his clients like a milkmaid with high-speed hands. He was moving so fast, You couldn't see him. He'd gone to the party as the Gilded Man from Four Color Comic number 422. And yes, the gold body paint was damned real. Not to mention the eagle feathers obtained at significant cost from one of the dealers in endangered species who supplied them with trophies for their houses. The secret gunroom in their palatial Turtle Bay brownstone contained, along with its bald eagles and the spectacular narwhal that Rob had nearly gotten himself killed catching, their ultimate prize. An entire pack of wolves, pups included. They'd shot them from a helicopter in Alaska, and the most delicious part of it was the hunt had been entirely legal. When you opened the front door of their house, the first thing you saw was the wolves, all magnificently preserved, staring right into your face. The illegal heads were kept deeper inside. The gunroom was closed to all except other endangered collectors. Their next hunt was going to be in the Russian Primois. There were about 20 Amur leopards still back in those deep forests. The plan was to take two, get the taxidermy done in Russia, then smuggle them home. When you entered the gunroom, they would be waiting for you, ready to pounce. Magnificent. A big part of the pleasure of all this was the process of corrupting people. Watching the rubes drool over peanut bribes, taking things that it was illegal to take, spitting in the face of the law. It was fun, just plain fun. On planet Earth, money rules, not law. As these thoughts passed through his mind, Rob found himself gazing at Jane. She was as pale as powder, the softest, most blonde woman he had ever met. Beautiful innocence. When she smiled, you thought, little girl. You thought, saint. That was her power. On the phone, she sounded like a sex kitten with a genius-level grasp of the markets. She was a genius, all right. You had to be to work here. A genius at separating marks from their cash. Rob listened to her working, the hypnotic rise and fall of that voice, so moist with sex that the guy on the other end of the line was going to get a hard-on, no matter what she was saying. She spouted numbers, great numbers. True, too, in a sense. Like all their false companies, EnviroMedical looked like something. If you went to its office in Greenwich, you found real people. If you investigated its balance sheet, you found real money. Because the profits it was making were entirely real. But if you went to the factory in China, where the drugs were manufactured, you found just two machines in a filthy, rat-infested warehouse. Between them, they turned out a million fake chemotherapy capsules a week for the African market. As long as they weren't sold at home, Chinese regulators didn't give a damn. As long as they didn't come into the U.S. or the EU, no real drug authorities would ever inspect them. So the profits rolled in, and the marks bought and bought and bought the stock. Eventually, when the marks owned all the stock, and Roper was short a couple of billion shares, Chinese regulators would be paid off to shut the outfit down. All the profits now in clients' hands would flow right back to Roper. That's how they did it, and there was basically no way anybody was ever going to see the crime. A couple of Chinese managers went to jail? Sure. Ching chong, bye-bye. She hung up the phone, hit a red button, and rang the bell. Damn her. What you wearing this year, he asked, trying to seem unconcerned by her success. She fixed her steel blue eyes on him. She smiled. Go fuck yourself, she said. Last year, she'd lost Halloween. big time. She'd come as Marie Antoinette and would have everyone believe that the tiara she was wearing had actually belonged to the queen. But she'd been snookered by a fake jeweler, a real expert called Pierre Galland. The instant Rob had heard that name, he knew she was in trouble. He'd waited until the party was in full swing, then had taken the tiara off her head and sunk it in the punch. What had come back was wires and rubble. For Rob, it had been a moment of purest triumph. They hated each other. She was his worst competitor. They loved each other. She was his best lay. You'd see them late in the night, walking home from dinner together hand in hand, young lovers rich enough to own a $20 million townhouse. Ha, youth! They would shake the world in their bed at night. Then they'd fight in the office for every scrap of sucker meat, two tigers circling, as ready to slash one another's throats as they were to deball the next client. Her phone rang. She snatched it up, listened for a moment, then hammered her fist down on the red button. Nick yelled, "She's hacking balls, guys, so where in hell are you?" She'd been making mysterious trips somewhere on the subway, which meant only one thing to Rob. They had to do with the costume. She wouldn't be caught dead in a subway unless she was working so hard to keep a secret that she wouldn't even risk letting her driver know where she was going. At last, the markets went to night volume and the office stripped out, and Rob said to her that he was working late. She left, her hips swaying, her eyes blank with the indifference of the victor. She had to be going for a fitting, and he had a plan. As soon as she left, he leaped up from his desk and headed for the stairwell. Running like a burning cat, he made it to the lobby just as she was disappearing into the street. Ignoring her waiting limo, sure enough, she went down into the subway. Waving his own car off, he followed her, taking the steps six at a time, fumbling for his little-used Metro card. He rode in the car behind her out to the wilds of Brooklyn, past the Heights, even past Park Slope, deep into Sunset Park. Finally, she stood up. He was far down his car, huddled beside a bum who smelled like a dead bum. The doors rattled open, but she didn't leave. Just stood there. Obvious ploy. He got ready to dash. As the doors clicked, getting ready to close, she stepped out. He dove out of his door, immediately throwing himself down beside a long-abandoned newsstand. The train roared away. He listened to the silence. No sound of footsteps on the stairway. She could be hiding near the old ticket booth, but that wouldn't be like her. She was too aggressive to hide. It wasn't her style. He gambled. Moving fast, he mounted the steps and went out into the cold and windy streets of Sunset Park on a winter's night. After a moment, he saw an unmistakable figure moving swiftly along 45th Street. She was headed under the Gowanus toward the water. She loved cold and had left her long, black panther coat open. She claimed that it was faux, of course, but the pelts were real. She was wearing $600,000 down what looked like a damn mean street. But that was Jane. She did it her way, and she expected to win. Absolute confidence. She also carried a very lethal little AMG 32, a small gun with plenty of stopping power. That at least was legal. The way the coat flowed and flapped in the wind, it made her look like the angel of death. The last light glowed in the sky. The bare trees rattled. A tang of smoke sharpened the air. She stepped into a basement door and was gone. He went up to it. Nothing to see, just a dingy old door under the stoop of one of the drab brownstones that lined the street. He waited at the end of the block, waited an hour, another. Finally, she came out, moving like a ghost, swift in the night wind. She made her way back up the street toward the subway station. He went to the brownstone, to the door. No mark on it, no name, just weathered black paint. He knocked, waited, knocked again, waited more. He had turned away and was mounting the steps when the air around him seemed to change, to grow somehow darker, somehow colder. A creeping loneliness filled his heart, emotions that seemed to come from nowhere. A sense of space behind him told him that the door was now open. Inside, he could see a hallway, or rather a path made through great piles of books, newspapers, old clothes in heaps and on racks, cloche hats and rotting crinolines, button shoes so old they were crisp, and books and books and books. Sartor Resartus, Seneca's plays, Cujo, Naked Lunch, hundreds of titles in crazy stacks. He threaded his way toward a dim light that he could see ahead, finding at last a tiny space lit by a single lamp shining down from the rafters. On the left was a wall of books. The right side was occupied by a railroad kitchen. A kettle boiled on an old stove. The air was dense with the smell of cabbage and blue with cigarette smoke. Directly ahead, a darkly clad figure hunched over a clattering sewing machine. The figure was running what looked disturbingly like skin through it, stitching two limpid, flesh-colored slabs together. Beyond the figure was a wall of glass that must lead into a dark back garden. Hanging from hooks along this wall were what appeared to be bodies. They were so realistic that he almost screamed. But then, no. They were costumes, all right, and they were amazing. Dracula, his eyes glaring as if alive, seemed ready to come down off his hook and latch onto Rob's neck. Pris, the furious female replicant from Blade Runner, looked about to cartwheel over and get him into a deliciously painful headlock. Jesus appeared like he'd just emerged from the tomb, his long hair and beard glowing, his lips parted as if he was just about to utter the final word of wisdom. Arnold Schwarzenegger was there, and Barack Obama, Jennifer Lawrence in a pink cocktail dress, Amy Adams in an SS uniform, Donald Trump looking very powerful and very pleased. And then there were the animals, endangered species, superb examples, a panda, a gorilla, an orangutan. What wonderful fun to go in the costume of an animal that you secretly possessed. No wonder she'd come here. She was going to blow him out of the water. Not. Without turning around, the figure at the sewing machine croaked, "What?" It was a female voice, old but sharp with demand. I guess I'm here for a costume. The figure stopped, turned. $100,000 cash now. She held out her hand. Rob had passed big cash many times, and you weren't going to put $100,000 in anybody's hand. The largest bill now in U.S. circulation is the C-note, so you'd need 1,000 bills, which makes it a briefcase deal. I don't have that kind of money with me right now. How did you find me? I heard about you from a friend. No. People talk. Not about me. I kill yappers. Uh-oh, crazy person, time to get out of here. He turned around, intending to leave the way he had come, but found the figure barring his way. No. Oh, how in hell? You want a costume? It wasn't a question. The light was behind the figure, which was clad in a black monk's robe. The cowl cast the face into deep shadow, but Rob could see eyes, calm and steady, unconcerned, even a little bored. Not for $100,000. Fine, then it's free. Thin arms rose. Skeletal fingers pushed back the hood. Rob found himself looking at a very old woman, tight lips puckered from smoking, nose as narrow as a blade, white hair neatly bunned. She smiled, drawing the lips back past a row of sharpened teeth. God, awful creepy. Come on, she said, her voice warm now. Still uneasy, but too fascinated to try again to leave, he followed her back into her workspace. She gestured toward the dangling shapes. For money, you have your choice, she said. She went to an old dresser that was almost hidden back among the books. But for free, we do this. She opened a drawer. Inside was a misshapen figure folded in on itself. Its face looked like a withered pumpkin. What is it? She reached in and drew the slack figure out, cradling it in her arms. Now the face became clearer. He gasped, took an involuntary step back, then choked back a small, awed sound. He mustn't let the old woman know that this was by far her best costume. The eyes glared, gray and intractable. The teeth shone like pale knives behind the cruel lips. It's what? A werewolf? Sure. Do you like it? His heart skipped a beat. He gave no indication of his excitement. It's okay. Thank you. She laughed a little deep in her throat. I've discontinued it. It doesn't sell. This is the last one. Perfect. Okay, I'll take it off your hands. She reached up and ran her fingers along his cheek. Her touch was cold, vaguely sickening. These costumes are made with an organic base. You'll need to get in about 2 hours before you go out in it. Lie still. You'll feel it gradually getting tighter. Think of it as kind of baking in. Gradually, you'll stop feeling a border between your skin and the costume. She paused, then smiled with her dagger teeth. That's when you're cooked, ready to go out and fun. What about taking it off? She shrugged her shoulders and shook herself. We shake out of it. It would be the best costume anybody had ever seen. It would hit the party like a damned tsunami. And he was beating the old fool out of the damned thing. Damned beautiful! She told him to keep it in the fridge like meat until he was ready to use it. She showed him how to split it down the back, revealing a complex interior colored in moist hues of pink and red and pale gray. It looked so much like animal fat that he reached toward it, thinking to touch it and see just how organic it was. Instantly, her fingers enclosed his wrist. They felt like wire. No, no, she said. If you touch, you activate. You need to put it on and run through a cycle. Take 6 hours. He wanted to ask how the hell it worked, but if he showed too much interest, she might change her mind about the cash. "Okay, got it. No big deal," he said, careful to sound noncommittal. If his sheer joy so much as peeked out from behind the facade of his face, she was liable to ask for some money, even if it wasn't $100,000. Jane had undoubtedly paid for what she'd gotten, and he wanted to be able to crow at the party about how he'd gotten his for free, for nothing, the most incredible costume ever seen. She wrapped it in butcher paper, put it in a shopping bag, and sent him on his way. As he walked up the long street in the freezing wind, he wished mightily for a cab, but there were no cabs in Sunset Park at this hour. He was relieved to get to the subway, glad when the R train came clanging and shrieking into the station, and almost bubbling with glee as he was whisked from station to station, the miracle costume safely in the bag carried on his lap. She had probably paid the $100,000 for some inferior costume. Arnold Schwarzenegger, she'd go for that. She'd want to be a man, or Hitler. The old lady probably had one hell of a Hitler packed away somewhere. When he got home, the house was silent. A light glowed from back in the kitchen. Faint music told him that upstairs, Jane was in bed. Good. Hopefully asleep. He didn't want to confront her just now. She might read his triumph in his face. She was skilled at that sort of thing. Then she emerged into the front hall from the darkened living room. "You've been at that goddamn whorehouse, you bastard. If you can't get it up, I'm going to whip your ass." She wore only a belt and boots. On the surface, she was every inch the dominatrix. But he had been married to her for long enough to know that this was just that, the surface. Stuffing his bag into the understairs closet, he went to her, took her in his arms, and lifted her up. He kissed her, forcing her head back, holding her against him until she was gasping. With a flick of his wrists, he pushed her away, causing her to fall to the floor in a heap. Then he was on her, pulling his pants down around his knees, forcing her legs apart, then blasting into her with the fury that she adored. Her enjoyment depended on this. If he wasn't aggressive, she couldn't let go, and if she couldn't let go, the river of her passion would not flood. She cursed him. She clawed at his chest. She tried to bite him. She called him a rapist. None of it mattered, as he well knew, and he plunged on into her heat and her desire. And when he expended himself, she came in unison, crying out like some shrieking bird of the night. "He sank down onto her," he said. "I was with Josie, if you must know. We did all kinds of shit." "Tell me." "69. Then she tied me up and made me kiss her boots." "Kiss mine, you bastard. Kiss my boots." "I can't." "Why the hell not? I'm with your wife, and she's just a damn whore." "Honey, you're barefoot." "Oh, yeah." They lay together. Far away somewhere a siren wailed. The wind moaned in the eaves. "Want a toke?" she asked. "You got what?" "I sorted some kush on the way home." They went upstairs together, took out their pipes, and smoked together. They were gentled now, the furies in their souls for the moment at rest. Rob and Jane, married in love and in hate. When they made love this time, there was a leisurely quality to it that lovers advanced in their relationships, sometimes in joy, when desire has survived familiarity. Perhaps it was because she saw the feminine in him and he the masculine in her, for there was something ambiguous in their sexuality, which was perhaps why this impossible marriage, full of competition and rage, continued to grow. Like a weed, yes, but also like some kind of dangerous flower. Late in the night, they went naked down to the kitchen, threading their way through their prized wolf pack in the front hall, and ate caviar out of tins and drank champagne. Around them, New York slept, its roar diminished to a sigh. Each in his own secrecy thought about their costume and the triumph to come. The next day, the office was sullen and expectant. This was because Nick had come clanking in already costumed at 8 a.m. He'd taken his golden-winged helmet off and now sat at his desk, resplendent in the original armor of the Qianlong Emperor. How he'd obtained it, whether on loan or stolen from the Museum de l'Armée in Paris, he wasn't saying. In any case, he was wearing the first-ever multi-million-dollar costume, and most of the Lone Rangers, Draculas, and Mickey Mice were devastated. Sure, you had to let the boss win, but this was ridiculous. Jane and Rob kept their own counsel. Neither of them had the slightest intention of revealing their costume until they actually swept into the Rainbow Room, which had reopened just last year and was now on the 65th floor of Rockefeller Center, once again one of the world's most splendid social venues. The two of them had agreed to go to the party in their separate cars. Rob had understood from hints that Jane had dropped that her costume was absolutely incredible. As well it might be. He could see her going as Pris from Blade Runner. That had been a hell of a costume. They were all great, but none was even close to the one he'd gotten for free. The werewolf, how perfect, given that their wolf pack was the dominant decorative element in their house. On this day, the million-dollar bell was quiet, and even Nick didn't mind. Over time, the Halloween party had become the firm's central event. Their year ended with the blowout on All Hallows. Rob pretended that he had a sucker lunch, but actually went back to the house, got his costume, and took it to the suite he kept at the Waldorf. Two bedrooms, fridge stocked with incredible food, wine cellar with ancient vintages. Here he romanced clients and other men's wives. He had a need to take not only money from other men, but also their women. He raped lives and loved every minute of it. Jane also pretended that she had a sucker lunch, but actually went to her suite at the Sherry, where she already had her costume laid out and waiting. In this suite, she screwed anybody she needed to screw for whatever reason. She liked to screw clerks for free clothes from Bergdorf's and Bonwit's, or to get a discount on the exquisite antique jewelry at A la Vielle Russe downstairs. She liked kinks and did her thing up here, playing out her fantasy of being a lady wolf in a sty full of terrified hogs. The sweetness in her had been hurt a lot when she was a kid. Her dad, her older brother, her priest, you name it, they could not resist Jane Candy. She got hers back with a whip. Not on Rob, though she'd consider it. No, he was her one master. With Rob, she was the melted female. Not up here, though. No way. She'd had the place well soundproofed, so once her mark was tied up, he discovered a few things he maybe hadn't known before about pain. The ones that came back were the best. She took their bodies, their money, their souls, everything, then spat them out like chewed plug. She and Rob both opened their costumes at about the same time and looked down into the strange, fatty interiors. Kind of moist and thick. Not uncomfortable, though. On the contrary, as they slid their bodies in, it felt like being embraced by a lover with a soft and intimate touch. They followed instructions to the letter, and by the time evening was falling, the costumes had taken. Rob gazed across his wide view to the north. taking in the twinkling beauty of the night through his werewolf eyes. They were sort of like contacts, not entirely comfortable, perhaps, but you got used to them quickly enough. He went into the kitchen and got a glass of water. To his annoyance, it poured out the sides of his long snout. Finally, he solved the problem by putting it in a bowl and lapping it up. The costume's extended jaw made it impossible to drink or to eat in any normal manner. At least Nick wouldn't expect him to bob for golden apples this year. Every year, people got their teeth busted doing that, which made Nick roar with laughter. They wanted the apples, though. Each one contained a couple of ounces of real gold in its skin. The party started at 7. At 6:40, he called down for his car and went into the hall. He was alone on his floor, but an elderly couple got on the elevator a few steps down. They practically choked. Silence followed him across the lobby, and he loved that, too. "Mr. Farley?" Jake was grinning hard, holding the Bentley's door open. Jake took a step back. "Excuse me?" Rob cleared his throat. The costume seemed designed to swallow his voice and make it into a growl. Cool touch, but not real convenient. "It's me, Jake," he said carefully. "We're off to the Rainbow Room." Jake peered at him. "That's damned amazing," he smiled, causing Jake to jump back. "Fuck!" Rob laughed. "Let's get this show on the road." When Rob had been a kid, the Rainbow Room was something you read about as a place of legend, an outpost of Valhalla. Like almost everybody else at the firm, he'd grown up blue-collar. In his case, on Staten Island. Jane had been raised in Flatbush, same as Rob. You grow up looking across at Manhattan. You want that. The floating jewel. He noticed that he got a few glances in the lobby. Excellent. He was alone in the express elevator to the 65th floor. It seemed an age before the doors opened. He stepped out into the sky lobby, then turned toward the room itself. From inside, he could hear the frantic wail of voices, people watching, evaluating, speculating, lives being ruined and reputations made. Ahead of him, Tommy Burt was turning in his coat. He was dressed in a toga, poor guy. A toga? Jesus. What was he planning to do before work tomorrow, kill himself? He had all of $50 on his shoulders. There was no need to wear a coat in this costume, not with all this fur. Wonderful stuff, undoubtedly real wolf. As he passed the coat closet, the kid burst out laughing. Rob gave him a growl, but he only laughed more. Seconds later, he realized why. Across the room, attempting to lap punch, was of all the goddamned things, another werewolf. "Shit!" Toga Tommy laughed at him. He was joined by Hitler and Rapunzel, one of the pros brought in by Nick, who also paid for their costumes. Traditionally, you could recognize them by the fairy tale themes. The other werewolf rose up from the bowl, turned, and glared at him. The damn thieving old bitch! He was going to go back out to Sunset Park and tear her throat out. How dare she? The other werewolf dropped down onto all fours. It was snarling, foam eddying along its lips as they curled away from its teeth. Rob fought the urge to go down himself, but then could not fight it. It was better this way, felt better. There was going to be a fight, and he felt way more in control like this. Around them, mad hatters, Hitlers, Rapunzels, goose girls, Hansels and Gretels, a great flopping pterodactyl, and the Qianlong Emperor made a circle. Everybody knew what was going to happen, the same thing that always happened when two morons showed up in identical costumes. And from the look of these outfits, the fight was going to be lots of fun. Pris was there all right, looking contented. Jane had gone in exactly the direction he had expected, and now she was watching Rob get his ass handed to him and loving it. Damn her! If the other werewolf was anybody Rob could fire, that individual was done. He glared into the face. Who in hell was it? The other wolf leaped at him. It was damn fast and damn strong, and he was sent flying. He scrambled to all fours and found himself going for the neck. They mixed it up, tearing at each other. The other one was a little smaller but faster than a striking snake. Damn strong, too. He sank his jaws into a foreleg. There was a snarl filled with agony and rage. But he heard not only those tones. There was also something else, a sound that surprised him, then didn't. The hell with Pris standing there grinning out of her dark and evil eyes. The other werewolf was his own wife. He'd heard Jane's voice in that growl. The moment he realized who it was, the other werewolf reared back. It tried to stand up, but dropped back down to all fours. They stood panting at each other, circling again. "Boring!" the Qianlong Emperor yelled. "We want blood!" The others shouted and clapped. "Blood! Blood! 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 Blood!" Rob managed a disgusted growl. "Let's get out of here, babes. This is a catastrophe." She drooped, then looked toward the door. Screw this, they loped out. "Whoever you are, you're damn well fired," the Qianlong Emperor jeered. "Fired!" Pris followed them, but nobody noticed that. She went into the ladies' room, but no costumed figure emerged. They got to the sky lobby. An elderly man joined them, not from the party, therefore nobody important. Nobody noticed that he had slipped out of the ladies' room. He stood waiting for the elevator, too, seemingly unconcerned by the two wolves who paced the floor behind him. Jane said something that Rob couldn't understand.
"You sound like a grand animal trying to talk." "What? We're gonna get out of these things. They're shitty."
Her reply was an indistinct growl.
"Stop it! Talk! Stop that growling, asshole!"
The express sped them to the ground floor. The old man, standing behind them, smiled, but they didn't see those familiar spiked teeth. In any case, they were entirely concentrated on their own problem. Get the hell out of these damned costumes! The thing to do now was to get to one of their cars. In the lobby, people screamed.
Rob shouted, "Take it easy."
This caused an eruption of shouting. A man swung at him with a shoe.
"Relax, we're crazy."
Something hot got poured on his back. "Don't do that," a woman cried. "Wolves don't hurt people."
"We're not wolves."
"It's snarling. It's going to attack." 911, we have an emergency," the doorman's voice intoned. "Two animals, apparently wolves, have been released into the lobby of 30 Rockefeller Center. We need animal control officers here right away." He stepped into the middle of the lobby. "Okay, folks, back off and stop bothering them. It's obviously some kind of Halloween prank. I'm sure they're harmless." The hair rose on the back of Jane's neck, and she growled. Rob could hear the menace in it. She was seriously furious, and he did not blame her. No wonder the old biddy had been giving away free costumes. They were so good that they were terrible. The cops would solve this. Help them get out of these damn things. Maybe a fine, then get the hell out of here. He was headed back to Sunset Park with a gun, just speaking personally for his next move. Two officers came in the front door, a couple of kids. When they laid eyes on Rob and Jane, they went white.
"War, help!"
Rob said. "Okay, folks, just back off. We want all of you off the floor as soon as you can. Just take it easy. Back away." Rob could hear the kid breathing. He could smell the salt of his blood. Smelled good. And he took another deep pull of it, sucking the air through his long nose. He was damned hungry, matter of fact. Four more cops came in. They had nets.
"Hurry! Hold on!"
Rob said.
"These were Halloween. No, these are Halloween costumes."
He tried to stand up.
"It's gonna pounce," a voice said. "Shoot it. Somebody's gonna get their throat torn out."
The next moment, Rob was in a net. He fought. He tore at the strands with his teeth, but he was dragged away out the main door and past a crowd that had gathered on Fifth Avenue. He was dumped into a big cage on the back of a truck. Jane was beside him, methodically gnawing at her own net. They were taken to the Central Park Zoo. Trapped in one of the small cages, they found themselves pacing away the hours of the night. They shook and shook, but the costumes did not come off. In fact, they didn't feel like costumes anymore at all. Dawn came, and with it a zookeeper with slabs of half-rotted meat. Brisket, some even cheaper cut. They gobbled it, and Rob was amazed at how good it tasted. They tried to work the lock with their paws. Fail. People passed the cage with dull, disinterested eyes. Sad men and women, kids who never looked up from their phones. A day passed without making a dime. As evening fell, Rob cried. He actually cried. Or rather, he felt like he was crying. The wolf that he had become drooped a little, hung its head, and drooled. Every day they were thrown meat, and the meat was good, and they ate it all. At night they screwed and lingered butt to butt, like dogs do, panting and waiting for their bodies to release, remembering the wonderful lives that had been theirs, the food, the drink, the fabulous possessions, and the delicious pleasure of just plain greed. In the outside world that they no longer knew, they were listed as missing persons. Eventually, the police entered their house. The state of New York was their only heir. So their possessions were sold at auction. Not the illegal stuff, of course. The wolves were not there, but nobody knew that except old Annie Ross and her team, warriors against all that people like Rob and Jane stood for. Annie's genius was sewing, and perhaps a little magic, or more accurately stated, forgotten science. Somewhere behind the old stories of shape-shifting, of werewolves and such, after all, there is a lost truth. Annie knew it. Here and there in the world, others knew it. High magic, high science. At the zoo, the sun rose and fell on the cages and the pacing, swinging, staring animals. Winter came and the blowing snow, then spring and the blowing blossom. On the air, Rob and Jane caught scent of the distant forests, and in their hearts joined the longing of other hearts in the zoo. Every so often, the old woman would come and watch them, a cigarette hanging out of the side of her mouth. Annie brought them dog biscuits. The zookeepers looked the other way. She had been feeding certain of the animals for years. Rob and Jane gobbled the biscuits and hated themselves for it. But they were wolves now, and so always hungry. They liked their meat best not just raw, but bloody and a little rotted. They were still connoisseurs, but their tastes had changed. The gorillas followed Annie with their eyes, beads of hate, tears falling like rain. One of the snakes, the biggest of the pythons, utterly despised her and coiled and hissed when she passed through the little reptile room. Rob and Jane lived by their noses, scenting the distant forest and dreaming of great woods in the moonlight and running deer and other things of which wolves may dream. They lived for many years in that cage. One morning, Jane, now gone gray around the eyes and soft of muscle, did not come out of her hutch. The zookeepers took the body away, and with it Rob's heart. He languished for another couple of months, but then death, in its mercy, took him, too. In the zoo's records, after the date of acquisition was added, the date of decease. As to origin, the records contained only one simple word: unknown.